Hello friends, let us now learn some important points about heart failure. Okay, heart failure. So in heart failure, there will be cardiac pump dysfunction. So now because of this cardiac pump dysfunction, this will result in decrease in stroke volume, which will result in decrease in cardiac output. Okay, because of decreased cardiac output, there is decreased blood pressure and there is decreased perfusion. This decrease in cardiac output, blood pressure and decreased perfusion, this is sensed by carotid sinus receptors. It is activated by or sensed by carotid sinus receptors or aortic arch receptors and renal afferent arterioles. Okay, because of all these will result in three processes. One, it will cause augmentation of sympathetic outflow. It will result in augmentation of sympathetic outflow. Okay, it will activate the renin angiotensin aldosterone system. It will also cause non-osmotic release of renin angiotensin. Non-osmotic release of vasopressin will also occur. Okay, so because of this, renin angiotensin aldosterone system will cause sodium and water retention, and it also causes peripheral vasoconstriction. So because of this, this will lead to peripheral edema. There will be also increased hydrostatic pressure is also seen. Right? Now, so this heart failure can be of two types. Okay, there can be right heart failure and left heart failure. Left heart failure can be there and right heart failure can be there. So we will take some differences between right heart failure and left heart failure. Here left heart failure is in this, here the problem is in the left heart, a failure of left heart. So as a result, there will be fluid congestion is seen in the lungs. Whereas in right heart failure, here the fluid congestion is mainly seen in the systemic circulation. Here the fluid congestion is seen in systemic circulation in right heart failure. In left heart failure, pulmonary capillary wedge pressure is increased. In right heart failure, pulmonary capillary wedge pressure is normal because there is no problem in lungs. Right? Then, but if the right heart failure, if right heart failure occurs secondary to left heart failure, then there will be pulmonary capillary wedge pressure will be increased. So if you see the right heart failure symptoms, the patient will have dyspnea, orthopnea, the patient will have paroxysmal nocturnal dyspnea, he will have cough with pink frothy sputum, then he will have rails or crackles. Okay, then if you see symptoms of right heart failure, you will see presence of ascites, congestive hepatomegaly will be there. Then you will see presence of congestive splenomegaly, hepatomegaly, splenomegaly is seen. Then you will see presence of weight gain, nocturia is seen, raised JVP is seen, and you will also see positive hepatojugular reflex. So these are the main differences between right heart failure and left heart failure. right, even in, yeah, so these are the main important differences. Then right, now let us learn about the NYHA classification of physical inactivity, okay, of dyspnea, because dyspnea is a predominant feature. We will see NYHA classification of dyspnea. So if you see class 1, there is no limitation of physical activity. In class 1 there is no limitation of physical activity. In class 2 there is slight limitation of physical activity, where there is which will result in fatigue and dyspnea or palpitations are seen with ordinary physical activity. With ordinary physical activity, the patient will have dyspnea, fatigue and palpitations are seen. Then if you see class 3, here there is marked limitation of physical activity is seen. What does marked limitation means? This means the patient has less than ordinary physical activity. If he does less than ordinary physical activity, will result in fatigue, dyspnea and palpitations. Then if you see type 4, in type 4 the patient is unable to carry out physical activity without discomfort. He is unable to carry out any physical activity without discomfort. This is type 4. Okay, then we have one more important criteria for heart failure, that is Framingham criteria, Framingham heart study criteria. According to Framingham heart study criteria, if you see, we have major criteria and then we have minor criteria. So if you see major criteria of Framingham heart study, this includes, we have paroxysmal nocturnal dyspnea, PND, there can be neck vein distension, the patient will have rales, then cardiomegaly is seen, then the patient will have acute pulmonary edema is seen, then the patient will have S3 gallop, okay, you will see increased venous pressure which is more than 16 centimeters is seen, and even circulation time of more than 25 seconds is seen. And one more major criteria is hepatojugular reflex is positive, okay. So these are the major Framingham criteria. Whereas if you see minor criteria include ankle edema, nocturnal cough is seen, then there will be hepatomegaly will be seen, and you will see pleural effusion, okay, and you will also see vital capacity reduced by 1/3 from predicted, and then you will see tachycardia. So these are the minor criteria of Framingham heart study. Then we also have major or minor concern. What is major and minor or minor criterion? Major or minor criterion is weight loss of more than 4.5 kgs over 5 days in response to treatment. That is, by giving diuretics, if the edema decreases so that the weight loss will be more than 4.5 kgs is major or minor criterion. Then what is the criterion for definitive congestive heart failure? If there are two major criteria, or if there is one major criteria and two minor criteria, then it is definitive congestive heart failure. Okay, so this is Framingham study heart study criteria. Right. Thank you for watching.